Okay, so we are about to begin this little session. So for people who are online, so be patient a little bit because we're still waiting people here in Geneva. So on arrive, allez boire un café, prenez un verre d'eau, installez-vous derrière votre ordinateur. Have a coffee, grab a glass of water, we'll be back soon. As soon as people here arrive in this little room in Geneva, Centre international des congrès. À tout de suite. Merci.
Every day, find a call. another chance to grow. Let love illuminate the place where light is dimming.
There's one place that I know that is a gift unto the giver, and that's a random act of love.
Welcome to this human rights session of the ICMP. Please take seats. As you know, the human rights session is a traditional ICMP event, but this time we decided to turn it in a slightly unusual direction, so it will be addressing equal opportunities and gender balance issues in sciences in general and in academia. And we are very happy to present the moderator of this session, Tanya Chitil. So she's a journalist and producer at the Swiss radio and television. Among other things, she is a specialist in issues related to science and to complex topics. And I think that's an ideal combination for today. So, and Tanya will present the members of the round table, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And this is a complex subject, but I won't be alone. So actually, yes, I'm a woman, I'm a mother, I'm a journalist, so I think I fit in that panel, because they are not all scientists, I can tell you. They are doing different science. For example, we've got here Deborah Madsen. She's at the University of Geneva. She's a professor in American studies in the English department, and she's also a mentor. And we're talking about that mentoring program later on with you, and that's why you are here also. And we not have to be in physics or in mathematics to be touched or concerned by this subject, I think. Then we have here today with us Eva Miranda. You're a full professor too in geometry and topology at UPC and CRM and at the Observatoire de Paris also. So I put all the middle, as you said. Yeah, you've got all of that. Then just beside you, we have Anna von Kuberta from EPFL in Lausanne. You're a professor too. You are specialized in semiconductor materials, especially in nanotechnology, and you're working with solar cells, we can say. So you're the future for us too. And just beside you, we've got a male. We've got a man, and I'm very proud to have a male in this, because even we are talking about women and science, I think it's a topic who concerns everybody. So I'm very glad to welcome you, Jörg Fröhlich. You are professor emeritus in ETH in Zurich in theoretical physics, and you're also a SwissMap member. I said everything okay? Yeah, and you're very concerned. We are going to listen to that during that that session about women, about science, and about gender. You know, sometimes it's very 2021, this topic, and I think I'm very glad to see young people here and young men and women, and I can tell you bon appétit in French. So if you are online, I'm sure you're maybe eating as well. They're eating delicious little sandwich. It's very pandemic stuff. Okay, so It's the first session entirely dedicated to women in science, and which is a great thing, I think. Actually, it's a bit strange for me because, you know, I did my studies not in physics or mathematics because I just studied law, but in the late 80s and beginning of the 90s, last century. And I thought that in 2021, it's going to be over. I thought when I was 20 that we won't have to talk about that stuff. And actually, I was totally wrong. But I think we have a great topic here today. So we're going to speak together about outreach and women-dedicated events and mentoring, three topics. And each of them are going to be introduced by a little video. So I propose you now to watch the first videos, and it's about outreach.
The Junior Oil Society started 14 years ago. It offers school children, boys and girls from 8 to 18 years old, the opportunity to learn mathematics beyond the school program. We're glad to say that the number of girls participating at our courses are steadily increasing over the time. And nowadays, we have even more girls than boys in several courses. I think that the existence of the International Girls Mathematical Olympia also contributes to the self-confidence of our girls. The fear of not being good enough by thinking boys are more talented and gifted. This can be approached by working with their individual personalities and providing women role models girls can identify with.
Girls-only activities can really help to draw them in. Events like the European Girls Mathematical Olympiad can prove to girls that they are not alone in their passion.
Exactly, and such activities give them the chance to get to know other girls that they would not have met otherwise. One of the problems with the gender gap in STEM fields is being confronted with certain stereotypes from a very early age. I don't think that girls are necessarily less interested in mathematics, but growing up, they may feel like the only girl pursuing this direction. While we need to motivate girls to be more confident in male-dominated fields, we also need to encourage guys to be more confident in female-dominated areas.
To sum this all up, we need to lift the stereotypes and see each person as a human, regardless of their gender or their personal preferences.
Okay. So you have here little remarks and sentences, and I want to hear you about that, because is it so complicated now at the first part of this new century to just to tell girls, okay, you can go on, you can be good on math? Is it not it's not like that at school anymore? Is it still like that at school, Eva? I'm sure you have got something to say.
Well, some years ago, I mean, when I was young, this is a long time ago, I think things were a bit better. But now with the crisis, I think there is a step back and women are losing confidence. I mean, already the girls at the school are losing their confidence. And well, we saw Anastasia in this video. I like her a lot. She should be here. She was saying, like, we have to draw women in by this European Olympiads, for instance. At the beginning, when this movement of European Olympiads was doing for girls, I thought that this was not a good idea, but I think this is a way to draw, as she was saying, them in. So I think it's a good strategy. We need to advance and improve things, and I think there's a first important step.
Yeah. It's an important step, but does we need to do special stuff for girls? And can't we say, you know, have an event for boys and girls and just tell girls, just go?
Well, I mean, we should do a reset, okay? If I could do a reset, like a computer, and start from zero, it would be great. But while society's church already with these stereotypes, that I think in order to balance up, we need to put on the other side of the balance more weight, and to do things that may sound a bit artificial, like to have these girls-only events. I believe that this is a good first step. And when things are back to a balanced situation, then we don't need to worry about this anymore.
Jörg Fröhlich, I want to hear male voice.
Well, I cannot imagine that introducing an Olympiad for girls will change the situation substantially. In fact, I think too much emphasis on competition is actually not good. Life is sufficiently competitive as it is already. But let me give an example about what could be done. France had an École Normale Supérieure de Jeunes Filles, and this was only for girls, and it was abolished at some point. And the experience is that as long as girls had their separate university education, there were more women who studied things like mathematics and physics and so on than now where they are mixed. So this means that apparently it is still not so normal that girls and boys sort of compete in the same subject. And perhaps it would make sense to reintroduce special schools for girls.
It's
a possibility.
Yeah, Anna.
So I have an 11-year-old daughter, and she's in a school where there are small classes, but sometimes she drops some activities because the boys at that age and before, they can be difficult. And she has a hard time with that. Boys, when they lose, they are very bad against the girls at that age. And you know, maybe the teachers are not good enough in educating them. But sometimes it's hard. And maybe having some island of peace in which they can be with their friends and you know, excel at their, without having to deal with the guy that loses, it may help. It's not the only way, but it certainly for some girls, it is a way to go.
So, Deborah, it's not a step forward, it's a step en arrière. I don't remember in English.
Backwards.
Thanks.
Well, I think that it's a step sideways, perhaps. But in my field, of course, in the discipline of the humanities, we do not have a difficulty attracting female students. What we do have is a difficulty promoting women into senior positions. So we have majority female undergraduates, majority male full professors, and that's an issue. Related, I think, to this question of women's invisibility and inaudibility, that women are not seen in the same way as their male colleagues, they're not heard in the same way. And so outreach, which is the topic of the video, I think is very important for presenting young women with senior female role models to counteract that stereotype that, yes, girls can be kindergarten teachers, they can be maybe even teachers in high school, but full professor, that doesn't fit the stereotype. So changing the imagery is a very important dimension of outreach, in my opinion.
Yeah, but I think that we're trying to do that for more than 10 years, just showing people. Actually, I'm working for the Swiss TV. 10 years ago, we were already doing shows and everything with, you know, women and science and everything. So we're doing that job, but it's not enough. Why isn't it not enough? For example.
Well, I think we're fighting a battle against the entire culture. I mean, this was mentioned, that the academy is embedded within a very particular society. I say a society, but of course there are multiple societies. Each national system is embedded within a particular culture and then within microcultures. But we also have the global entertainment culture, to take one example of a very powerful purveyor of gender stereotypes. And so the battle, you know, sorry Jörg, to use this sort of martial competitive metaphor, but that struggle is against very, very powerful opposing forces, I think.
And how was, because you are all, you know, professor or ex-professor, so was it a battle for you, for example, Anna? So?
No, it was not a battle. I'm not very martial. I am advocate for peace, I would say. But I was very lucky. I had very early on people that gave me the space and believed in me. And in my school, it was tolerated. You could be good at math. And, you know, I was very bad at sports. People would laugh at me when I would try to do some sport. But I understood why they were laughing. It was not laughing at me. Because it was funny. I was very bad. I was laughing too. But, you know, and then I would be good at science and math. And, you know, people would, they would profit from it because maybe I would explain them things. So it was very, you know, human and taking people for what they are. And from that on, I had the chance of people believing in me and supporting me. And this gave me a base from which I could fly, even though later on I could maybe find some people that were less nice with me. I had this strong belief in myself.
And you, Eva?
Well, I mean, I was not, I didn't have any permanent position in 2015. And now I am full professor. So things went very quickly from 0 to 100%. And yeah, I did have to battle. I did have to try hard. I did have to prove that I was good enough. I was questioned, I'm sure. I mean, I was questioned, I'm sure. And this is something that when you are in this battle, because we are always learning, like in life, right? But there is a moment in which you are really very young, and you really think something is not. And so you work and work and work and work and work a lot and work so much that you get the permanent position you get. In 1 year, it's full professor because you had been like, you had such an amazing CV, like at that stage that, okay, then somebody said, oh no, but she deserves a full professorship. Of course, I had to apply many times to get to that. And it was, I mean, at that moment, you don't think it's a problem of gender. But once you are in your position and then you can breathe and go on with your life, you look back and you remember situations, and yeah, there is some gender bias. I mean, I believe that, I don't want to talk in first person, but I believe that many brilliant mathematicians and people in mathematical physics who are women have to strive and prove much harder that they are good for the position that the male, that for the same position. And this is our problem. I mean, and this is something that it's not, the people who judge are male and female, but I think that, I mean, we know that there is this, I mean, the gender bias and is unconscious, and we know that this is real. And there are studies that prove this. Like there is a study in 2012, which was done in Yale University, where there was a committee formed by male and female judging two candidates. The CV was the same. The only thing that was different is the name. One was John and the other one was Jennifer. And John was more brilliant than Jennifer according to the marks that he got, even if the CV was exactly the same. So this experiment proves that bias is real. So this is something that you realize, as I said, I didn't realize in the process, but I'm sure that some of my colleagues, I mean, it's a fact. Some of my colleagues, or even of people who studied with me, had it much easier to get their first position.
But don't we have, you know, maybe the danger is that we're doing the opposite now. So if you are a man now, you have no chance because they want to promote women. Is it,
I don't know a simple case of this. But I would be glad, I mean, it's good if I have an example of this. I would like to know, because then we are walking towards equality. I'm sorry for being so direct.
Do you know situation, or now maybe in certain fields, it's better to be a woman than a man because they want to promote women more than men, instead of equality?
I think it's conceivable that there are such situations. They are probably not very, you know, dominant yet, so I'm not too worried about this particular aspect. You know, what is important is when you want to have a career in academia, then at the beginning of your career, you should have some well-established, well-known people who believe in you and support you. If that is missing, the career can be incredibly difficult. I was lucky enough, I had some people who believed in me. I'm not quite sure whether it had much to do with my sex, but that's a fact. Without those people, I probably would not have managed. So that's a very important thing. If we have good young people, we should support and promote them, and of course, independently of whether they are men or women.
We talk about that because we're going to talk about the topics of mentoring, but if we just keep in the outreach program, we saw an example with the junior society, Euler Society, which is an example at the EPFL of outreach and giving the possibility of young girls and boys who love math to do more than math, what they're doing at school. So you've got other example in your fields where that kind of initiative can be good. Have you heard about that? Because the Euler Society is very famous now in Switzerland, and a lot of girls, and they said in the video, sometimes more girls than boys go there.
I mean, that's probably a useful thing independently of whether you're a girl or a boy. It's certainly good to be supported in one's interests and helped to do a little better than average. So I don't see that as a gender issue.
It's for both. And do you know, for example, you, Eva, in your country or in the south of Europe or in France, do you know such initiative?
Yeah, there are several initiatives. In France, there is Femme Math, and in Spain and in Catalonia, there are several initiatives now to promote women, but not as good as the Euler Society. I think we need to learn a lot from them. And I enjoyed very much that video. I looked at it several times because it's very nice to see these three women, no, these three girls saying, oh yeah, I enjoy it. And I mean, they are doing it better than we are doing it. Maybe they should be sitting in this table.
And did you feel that, maybe I'm not talking to you, Deborah, because you're not in scientific things, but for me, it was a surprise just to hear we want to be with like-minded individuals. It's like we're part of the society. Do you feel really that in your fields? This.
Well, I mean, as I said, if I could do a reset in my computer and we would be born again, then everyone would be equal and we start from zero. It's really fantastic. But unfortunately, sometimes we are judged, and it's very nice to be able to see this sentence. I don't think we can say this sentence that she is saying in at this level. And this proves that it's very important to have strong critical mass, as she was saying, of women interested in science, so that we can just forget about having special activities just for women. That's what I think.
I don't want to jump forward into talking about mentoring too much, but that's really why I'm here, and it's what I really know about. But one of the great benefits of formal mentoring programs is, on the one hand, yes, to put mentees into contact with potential supporters, but it also enables the construction of communities of young scholars who support each other, and simply discovering that the struggles are not individual is hugely liberating and empowering, to find out, well, it's not my fault that my supervisor never proposes me for anything, but he does, my male colleagues. The same thing is happening to this woman in the law department and this woman in the medical school. The same things are happening. So this is a rather negative, I suppose, example of like-mindedness, but it is one of the areas where some formal system of support can be really helpful. I think in the past what happened was people either would or would not find their supporters. That's certainly what happened in my case. I did not get support from my PhD supervisor, did not get support from the obvious sources, but because I work in an interdisciplinary field like American Studies, I had access to people, I had connections with people in other departments, in other faculties, and could find my like-minded supporters who could help me. But it's great to have more formal structures in place now.
Anna?
I just wanted to add, I think in this OILAB program, I think one important thing, you are planting seeds. And at the ages where children are trying to find their identity, to find people like them that have interested in numbers or, it's kind of eye-opening, I think, for them, and they feel reinforced in their passion. Otherwise, maybe the passion would go down. So it's very important, as I think. The more we have these things, the better. For boys and girls.
Yeah, not to feel different. Yeah. Do we have any questions somewhere? Online or in the room? Yeah. Wait for the microphone. Thanks.
It's just a small comment, because since I'm from Zurich, the Junior Royal Society from the University of Zurich is not from the WPFL, just to make everybody know. So, but no problem.
Sorry, because I knew, actually, as I lived in Lausanne and Geneva, I know there is a branch, a thing in Lausanne. I'm sorry.
Okay, maybe there are.
So there is also one in Lausanne.
Okay, great.
Thank you very much. Another one? Yeah. We're bringing you the microphone.
Hello. I would like to ask regarding, essentially, as the discussion was before, about, for example, that it's expected for somehow teachers at elementary school or high school to somehow that it's okay to be women, as it was said here. And somehow now we are trying to promote that women should, for example, be also more involved in academia, but wouldn't be also actually good to not just to focus on what women could do, but also to somehow go that it's okay for men to be actually teachers at elementary school, for example, to somehow also actually do the other side of the message, because somehow I feel that sometimes the discussion is somehow now really one-sided.
Who wants to answer? Jörg?
Obviously, yes. In fact, I think we should not start too much of a sort of gender war in all these discussions. I think we have to strive towards a situation where we do not worry about whether a good candidate is a woman or a man, no matter what the position is that we are debating about.
Yeah, but we heard in the video saying, actually it's just the education, so saying you are a man, you can be a teacher for elementary school, or you can be a...
Too few men who do elementary school teaching, and some people claim that men are now missing as role models for the small school children.
Because girls want to be in love with their teacher as well. Not only boys being in love with their teacher. Somebody? Yeah, that's true. Yeah, that's true. It's terrible what I said, yes. But okay, forget it. We raise, yes. It's a platonic love, yes, of course. So it's a matter of education. What I can just say, because we were talking about outreach, and mentoring. So I propose to look at the second video here, talking about these topics, very important, which is mentoring for men and women.
Our research path does not unfold uniformly. We succeed and we fail. And at a time of a failure, one often has a feeling of being alone, of being worthless. Sometimes an opinion of a mentor who is outside the research group can be of great value. The SwissMap mentoring program operates at the national level, and it is composed of both physicists and mathematicians. Breaking boundaries between the fields and between the institutions leads to greater openness in the program, and it creates extra opportunities for networking. Often people with more serious problems are silent, and are not necessarily seeking help. Informal setting for discussions between potential mentors and mentees could be of key importance. It's a great thing to have a community of mentors who regularly discuss and exchange ideas. This is a space where we are all both mentors and mentees.
Whether a man or a woman, as PhD students, we all share uncertainties in life, and seeking help during these challenging times can be very complicated. Firstly, it's important to acknowledge and accept the need for help, as there is a general tendency to underestimate problems. Secondly, it's important to identify who to talk to. Establishing a first contact is very complicated, and for a successful mutual exchange, people should not be forced into mentoring programs. Often a promotional leaflet is not enough. Further, the idea of approaching well-known mathematicians can be very intimidating. People who succeed do not really talk about their own failures, which makes them appear more inaccessible. To provide more visibility about success stories of mentorship experiences, this could encourage others to participate. If we all speak openly about the obstacles we face, we could avoid the feeling of isolation.
Who had a mentor? You had a mentor? Who had? Yeah, Anna?
I think we all have mentors, but I didn't have it in this setting. But I mean, if you read the book of Sheryl Sandberg, about Lean In, there is a chapter on mentoring, and mentoring can be someone that you meet on a coffee at a conference and gives you good advice that serves you all your life, and you only met this person once, or someone that follows you maybe for a couple of years. I think you can take the chance of getting mentored if you're smart all the time. Now, I also take the chance now, even now.
Jörg?
So I don't think I had a mentor when I was a student, in fact. You know, the first year of my undergraduate studies was some kind of shock. But then I managed to establish social relations to some of the other students. And so we were a sort of group of students who would enjoy life, not just while listening to the professors, but also after studies, going downtown and enjoying evenings and discussions and so on. I think the social life is in many ways much more important than mentoring. I mean, usually you find out what you have to study, and but you need a social framework that gives you some kind of security and works against the feeling of being very lonely.
It's very important in that special year. 21 is not a very good year to have a social life, I think. Maybe you had some, if you're lucky. I know lots of people, students who had no social life at all. Eva, you had a mentor. What is your experience?
No, I like a lot the way Anna was expressing this. I think that mentoring, sometimes you find somebody. I mean, I had somebody who helped me a lot later in my life, and I think he acted as a mentor. But I think if I would have been super happy to have this person before. And this is why a program like the mentoring program that Deborah and Anton are working on, I think this is great, because you identify already the problems at the beginning, and these people already reconduct you. But I agree with Anna that we are always learning. I mean, we are full professors, but what do we know? We keep on learning. I mean, our job as academics is to start from zero and learn a topic from scratch. So mentoring is always important in life, in academia. So, yeah.
So, of course, we want to hear you, Deborah, about that mentoring program at University of Geneva. And so how is it possible, and how do you make it possible?
Well, the University of Geneva for the past 17 years has run two mentoring programs. They're administered by the rectorate, so the central administration, but work through the Service d'Égalité et Diversité, so the Equality and Diversity Service. One is a program for doctoral students and early career researchers. The other, I think in some ways, is more significant because it's an accompaniment to a grant. So young researchers can apply for a décharge. They can apply to have a certain percentage of their work replaced by someone else, so they have the funding for that. That is for a year. And a condition of the grant, which is supposed to be devoted to professional development, is that they work with a mentor. So the I think this is more significant because the university is actually putting its money where its mouth is in this respect, because they are paying salaries to replace some work time for young researchers who can then devote themselves to improving their CVs, acquiring professional skills, maybe doing that period of study internationally that they need to do to improve their job prospects. So I think that that is really important because there's actual money behind it. It's not just talking about the need for this kind of support, but really trying to do something about it. The scheme, in my experience, has been very successful, and very successful for perhaps for two reasons. The first is that in both schemes, the Montaja Relève, as it's called, which is like the it's just kind of lifting up a support program for early career researchers, and the subsidized program. I've lost my thread now. Both of them require that the mentor and the mentee be in different faculties, ideally, but in different departments, which means that this is a relationship that has nothing to do with the institutional hierarchy and has nothing to do with the disciplinary hierarchy either. So I can say to one of my mentees, oh, I think this work is really good. That doesn't mean I'm making a professional value judgment about how good the work actually is in a disciplinary perspective. It doesn't mean I'm making any kind of promise that might be misinterpreted about future prospects in the institution or in the discipline. So that flat, horizontal, non-hierarchical relationship is really important. And the other reason why I think that this this particular scheme is so successful is, and you know, I've forgotten what it is. It's that we have this horizontality. We have a relationship of equality. And yes, now I've remembered, if you talk long enough, it comes back to you. The mentor can be the cheerleader of the mentee, and this is so important that a mentor will give a certain amount of advice, especially for people who are not necessarily literate in how the university works. They don't know where to go for support. They may be a little bit illiterate in terms of how the discipline functions as well. I mean, ideally, a supervisor would be performing this kind of work, but unfortunately that doesn't always happen. So feedback, advice, but the motivation to go out and put that advice into practice, to like go out there and make yourself visible, make yourself heard, go and do what we've been talking about. Yeah.
Do you like it, Anna? What she said.
Yes, I like it. There's something I like also that was in the video, saying that the mentor also learns from the mentee. It's not one directional, I think. Mentoring students is also very good for the mentors, because you learn a lot. Maybe on some weakness you had some time ago that you didn't work on, and you know, you realize you have another angle. I think it's a nice relation also for the mentor.
Have you been a mentor for someone?
Hopefully I'm a mentor of all my PhD students. They keep coming back to me after graduating for advice and for discussion, so I guess I'm still a mentor, hopefully. I don't know, it looks like. But I think it's one of the roles that we have as a professors to have the door open and have students come and asking questions that have to do with the discipline, also something else. And when I'm in my office, my door is open, and I try to be open for that and mentoring as much as I can. I like this.
Eva?
Yeah, I am a mentor. I have now a lot of PhD students, and they also come back to me. And I think it's great what Deborah is explaining now. You want to be the cheerleader, And to be the cheerleader, then this dissociation of being somebody who is your not your advisor. I mean, the advisor ideally is somebody who has to do this. But sometimes it's good that it's somebody else who tells you this, because then you believe your advisor, because sometimes your advisor is your friend, your boss, who is your advisor. Well, and then to have this kind of cheerleader behind you, and there are moments in life for everyone where you, as Anton is saying in the video, where you feel like things are completely wrong and you want to stop doing something. And if you have somebody next to you who says, no, this is not a big deal, go on. I mean, this will pass soon, and just focus on this other topic. And I think this is great. I also try to have the door open to my students. And yeah, my PhD student, my former PhD students sometimes come back to me with all kind of problems, like not only mathematics. So I feel like I'm like a kind of guru mentor of them sometimes.
And I can tell you, it's not only in academia or whatever, it's in all kind of, you know, maybe not all going to stay in academia way. If you go to some big, you know, company or whatever, you're going to have exactly the same problem. So it's more a job problem than an academic stuff. Maybe if you're still in academia, you think you're alone to have that kind of problem. But it's really, it's a problem now, and I think we should have that kind of mentoring in all companies, because yeah, it's very useful. But give it that give you the, you know, the aim to do something like that in your own university, because it's not that easy to organize. Like that, the idea is fantastic, but to organize it, and as you said, it's a matter of money too. Maybe here in Switzerland we've got...
You have more money here in Switzerland, yeah. Let's face it.
Yeah.
There is also one thing about what says forcing. I'm a member of the mentoring of Swiss Romande, and I have never been contacted by anybody. Mm. And so I think... So I'm part of this réseau, but I've never been contacted. So probably, you know, this that, you know, trying to make people, force people a bit to make the step is a good thing too. Yeah.
Yeah, because maybe people doesn't know it exists.
Or they don't dare. Know. Maybe they don't dare, as yeah, they say. You know, it's intimidating to see a professor, but the professor was a student like you. I know, we all go to the same path.
Jörg, you wanted to say something?
No. Well, I wish I understood what people say somehow. Since I'm old, I don't always, you know, acoustically understand. But I thought I understood something about cheerleading. I think this is not the right notion. You know, for example, PhD studies are not always cheerful. There are periods when you're stuck on your problem and your advisor doesn't really understand the problem either, and then you have to fight. And what is more important is to express faith in your students that they will overcome and that they can accomplish something. That's really important. Cheers are for the evenings when we go out for beer. During the day we have to, you know.
It's a bit German what you're saying.
No, it's not German.
Cheers, we can have that all day, not only
I think we are too much developing towards a sort of cheer society. Life is simply not so easy. Sometimes you have to, you know, fight through the difficulties. But with the confidence that you can do it and that you can be successful in the end. And
Eva and Deborah wanted to...
I want to add something. I mean, yesterday we heard about mountains, right? How difficult it is, like the mountains here. And you can think of the PhD like a mountain. Like one of my former PhDs is Cedric Holmes, who likes a lot doing mountain and in his free time, in his spare time. And when he finished the thesis after this online defense that he had, like he expressed his gratitude. And for him, he was saying, well, you know, doing a PhD is like going up the mountain, right? At the beginning, you have your advisor who tells you, you have to get up the mountain. And then where is the cheerleading effect? Because you start going through a path, and this path maybe doesn't get you to climb up there, but you can descend and find another path, and for this you need a cheerleader, because otherwise it's very easy to say, okay, I give up, I go down the mountain, and I stop. And and the cheerleader effect, I believe this is important. And this is maybe something that your advisor is not able to bring because maybe your advisor is more technical, but there is a human side of the advising process for sure. And that's a little bit the PhD. Like you have this mountain, you know, you have to go up there, you try a way, it's hard. It's hard, yeah, it's hard. I mean, I'm not criticizing it's hard. I don't want to say that it's not hard. But to have somebody who tells you, look, try this other path, or do it again, or try this other mountain that is not so high. And then, as my student said it in the defense, and I was like very touched by his words, like there is a moment in which you just can go up and up and up until you are done with your thesis. So I think that the expression cheerleader is very appropriate in that sense. Not in a sense of saying that things are simple. Not, life is hard, but sometimes having a hand to help you is important.
Deborah?
Yeah, maybe cheerleading wasn't the best term to use. It evokes all kinds of inappropriate images. But really, it's having someone to say, you deserve this. You are worthy of this. Our university, many universities, put into place extensions for research contracts because of the lockdown during the early stage of the pandemic. I had a mentee who applied for this and was told, no, you have one of these mentoring subsidies that you've already got your time off. And she told me that, and I was so angry and said to her, like, you are entitled to this. You go back and you tell them that you are entitled to this. These are not the same kinds of grants. They're not the same program. But she would have accepted it. She said, they made their decision. That's okay. And she would sacrifice 6 months of research time as a consequence. So it's cheerleading in that sense of saying, you can do it. Go back there. Find the motivation to make that appointment to meet with the dean and demand your rights, really. I meant cheerleading sort of in that respect. And the discussion has also made me think of just another aspect of this mentoring process, which is, and the advantage of having a mentor who is not your supervisor, who is not in your department or in your research group or even perhaps in your faculty, is that there are, and it came thinking about blockages. Often writing blocks I've found in mentoring and in supervising research students have an emotional cause. There's some kind of belief or some kind of feeling that is generating a blockage. They're sort of very specifically about writing. But it can be quite difficult to explain to a supervisor or someone in your hierarchy that you have this emotional problem that is impacting your work. That can be difficult because then you're seen to be a little bit incompetent, not so good at your work, whereas the pressure is to be highly productive 24/7. So to be able to speak to a mentor who has kind of no responsibility into hierarchically for the mentee's position can be really, really helpful just to express that and then to talk about actual proper, well, what would you say, steps that could be taken to resolve that. I mean, one of the gray lines in being a mentor is the line between the actual supervisor of the mentee of the project and the mentoring process, and it's very important that the mentor doesn't try to do the job of a disciplinary specialist, which is an advantage of knowing nothing about the content of a mentee's research project. No, I cannot make judgments or give advice about the content, but I can talk about strategies for overcoming problems and getting the work done. And being the sort of cheerleader is part of that.
Jörg, you wanted to say something. I heard you.
Yes. So, you know, in a good relationship between a student and the advisor, you don't need too many further mentors. However, unfortunately, it happens fairly frequently that there's something wrong in the relationship between the PhD student and the advisor. And I think it is important at the university, if you have a problem with your advisor, you have to know where to go to discuss the problem and to get some help. It is a fact that PhD students are not really abused by their advisors. They have to do a lot of work, which the advisor is not sufficiently competent anymore to do by himself. And so then in such situations, you have to know where to go and where to get help.
Yeah, yes, exactly. Just to, we heard that in the video. It's if you need help, you don't have to stay silent and to don't to say anything. You have to know where to look for help. You wanted just to say before going? Yeah, we always have time.
What I wanted to add to what Deborah was saying and what was discussed about the mentoring process, I think that during the pandemics, this is very important. Because this, for instance, the write-up, when a PhD student is writing the thesis, they can be blocked. And during the pandemic, this lack of social life. And this is something in which the advisor cannot do miracles. So you can tell your student, you can do it, yeah, do it, come on. You know how to do it. But this student needs sometime a third person, precisely as Deborah was saying, because you feel like somehow you feel weak if you tell your advisor, like, look, I'm blocked, I cannot write down the thesis. Everything is there, all your results are there, go and do it. Like, you need somebody to unblock these situations. And with the pandemics, we've seen that situation very often. It's like, in some countries, like the lockdown was very real, and then you had to communicate by Zoom all the time. And Zoom sometimes works well, but with some people, it just doesn't work. So then I think it's very helpful. And it's very good that the University of Geneva is putting the money where the mouth is, as you said it. I wish we had this program also in Spain.
Thank you. So now we're going to see you in the next video, Eva. Yes. Now you look, it's good. It's great. I promise. You saw yourself, I know. And it's good. Yeah. We're talking about the women dedicated events. And I don't know. There are some questions. Sorry. Shaula.
Okay, just speaking. I have two online questions. The first is for Professor Fröhlich, and it is, how are your colleagues support you and how you support and mentoring your students? And the second one is, how about people that need help and that need support but is too shy to ask?
So the first is for you, Jörg.
I only understood the first question you asked, and you can ask Giovanni Felder and Benjamin Schlein. They were many years ago my PhD students. I think they are more competent in answering this question than I am. All I can say is I thought about the job I was doing, and I was trying to do it reasonably well, and whether I succeeded or not is not up to me to decide. So what was the second question? I did not understand it acoustically. About colleagues or what?
How you got help, how your colleagues supported you.
My colleagues?
Yeah.
They never supported me. I mean, I had colleagues whom I liked a lot. But, as many other people must have experienced, there are also colleagues who were extremely worried that I might enter their turf or that I would stand in their light or what. So, the atmosphere was not always particularly friendly, at least locally at the Institute. But you learn to live with that, and I have to say I did not suffer, I mean.
Anna, you wanted to say something.
So if I am where I am and I had chance to leave the institution I was, if I stayed, it's because we colleagues mentor each other a lot. If you go for an ERC interview, you have your mentor, there's an rehearsal at EPFL, but there's also your colleagues that will tell you, you suck, you know, and this is, we don't understand anything, this is bad, and they will tell you why it's bad, and maybe you want to cry, but you don't cry, and then that makes you success. So this is really colleagues that tell you the truth and want you to excel by telling you the truth, and they're not worried that maybe you have an ERC more than them, because it's all together that we make it a success. So if you have the chance to work in a place where people are really collegial and help each other, mentor each other, whatever the level is, that's really precious. And so look for these places, they exist.
And another one? No? Yeah.
Yeah, the second one was about the shy person.
Yeah. So I thought, I thought that the shy person could have an answer with a mentoring program, for example, at University of Geneva.
I think this is where an external system really has value, and especially one which will dangle the carrot of a few hours or a percentage of work time that is being replaced, that would encourage people to apply for a mentoring relationship. But I do agree with what was said in the video, that people cannot be forced into a mentoring relationship because it's a personal relationship. It becomes a very intimate relationship in a sense, because you can talk about anything, and you do talk about anything. So there is a level of trust that has to be developed, and that just isn't possible if someone is forced into a program to which they are resistant. There has to be an engagement on both sides, but really more, in fact, from the side of the mentee. It's one of the conditions of the University of Geneva's programs that the mentee takes primary responsibility for making sure that meetings are scheduled, that topics for discussion are actually discussed, and reports are written at the end of the year. So there is an element of accountability, but that can't work with someone who is resistant. So it is that is a kind of an issue. Mentoring would not be the answer. I would also think that someone who was so shy and so introverted that they cannot take a step to resolve their issues in the interest of their professional development needs more assistance than a mentor can give, because a mentor is not a therapist. I mean, that's another kind of gray line in a sense, but the mentoring relationship is very much a professional academic.
But that's
one.
True that it's not very easy just to say, actually, I've got problems, and to admit that we are weak and that it's hard, and it's really hard just to, first of all, to say that to myself, for example, but then to say to somebody who you can trust in the academia fields. And do you have, for example, Anna, in the EPFL, or where you got a place where the student or the PhD or whatever can go and say, okay, I need help? Do they have that kind of stuff?
So there are different kinds of psychological support if they need it. I think it could be even more. I think only two sessions are for free. I think there should be more for free. And depending on the doctoral program, there is either one mentor that is there to listen to everything and help communication, restart communication with a supervisor, whatever, or helping in a different way, like more like a, like what is known as a father or mother figure, and depends. We are now homogenizing this, but there is support. But yeah, the people that don't make the step to ask for help, you can kind of detect if you know the person that is going to a depression, if you know that, but if you don't, it's very difficult. Yeah.
So maybe the message we can just say to people, that talk, just go and talk. There is a question over there.
Yes, I wanted to say that in the doctoral program of my institution, we have a mentoring program which is compulsory. So every PhD student has to choose a mentor and have at least one discussion per year with the report and everything. And that I would say that this program works because I had several mentees, most of them men, but I have one woman, and I detected a serious problem, and I was able to help her. So if the system is not in place, we might lose the occasion, the opportunity to detect these problems, and the students might not dare to come and
talk.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Where do you come from? What is your institution?
So I'm in Saclay, Institut de Physique Théorique. So it's a part of the University Paris-Saclay. So the system was put in place like 5 years ago. It's workload for supplementary workload for all of us, which is more or less volunteer on a voluntary basis. But I think it's important. And also I wanted to say, on the earlier discussion about social life, it's very important for students to have a social life, to get support from the others. And of course, many things, many information, even scientific, is exchanged during this social life. And it's, from my experience, there were fewer women around when I was younger. It's more difficult for a woman to go and tell to the boys, let's go to have a beer together. So maybe on this aspect also, one can try to organize to do things more systematically and give opportunities to students in the department to meet and to start having a social relationship. So I think this is very, very important for everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Everything, yeah, so we heard that. Do you agree to go to the third topic, Shaula, or do you have another question? It's okay. So let's go to the third, you have a question. Or third, yeah, you can. There is a microphone with disinfectant.
Yes, when you will be half my age, even all of you combined, you will understand what hearing problem means. So I can only react to what I read from the video and what I read from this leaflet, so from this page, so flyer. So in the video and from the little I could hear, it is a good thing to be kind to younger, to junior. And here, they make fun about this concept, kindness versus equality. The people often want to be delicate and help younger colleagues and so on. Can you elaborate on this at least apparent contradiction? And I would have a second question to Jörg Fröhlich, because you are the only one I could hear being close to me. What do you think Karl Popper would think of all these debates about gender equality and human rights?
Go ahead.
Did you say Karl Popper?
Yes, the one who thinks that there is no science if you only have one possible statement without any possible contradiction.
Yes, well, I didn't realize that he was interested in the gender issue, but maybe he was. I wanted to say something else, maybe it's related. You know, we live in a society where the admission of weakness and of problems does not pass well. If you have, for example, a nervous depression, you have to hide it. You should not admit it. It's considered to be bad, and people might not take you seriously anymore afterwards. And that's a general problem. I think it's not just a problem for students to admit that they have a problem or that they feel down or depressed. It's also a problem for senior people. They also can be depressed. And it's just the way our society functions that one should not, apparently not admit it, which of course I find stupid, because if I have a flu, I also admit it. So if I have a problem of feeling depressed, I should be able to admit it and maybe try to cure it for a little while. So, but I have no idea what Popper would have said. I think maybe you could ask about Wittgenstein, what he would have said or so.
Thank you very much. Okay, let's go to the third topics. It's because we have a new schedule and we have to go further. So the third topics is women dedicated events. So maybe we're going into the gender battle a little bit more, but not that much. Have a look.
Why have women dedicated events? To boost contemporary female role models and to create new networking opportunities. It is fundamental that women are present as main characters, not just as participants of science. Women dedicated events are more important now than ever. The pandemic and the unlike academic life have increased the gender imbalance in science, and there are less women speaking in conferences. Why? Firstly, there has been a loss of financial incentive to have female speakers in workshops. Secondly, several important facets of a face-to-face event, such as women's networking and visibility, are lost in the new online scenario. Men sometimes might feel intimidated by these events. Indeed, they might think that these events are just for women, and not all the male scientists in the topic dare to participate. To avoid alienation and increase the number of men involved in the process, hybrid events should be promoted. This was the case of the workshop Women in Geometry and Topology in Barcelona. The protagonists were women as plenary speakers, but contributed talks were ungendered.
Traveling is essential in modern science. It allows to build a network and advertise your work. In the past years, I have received specific support to travel with my daughters. Without that, I would have been out of the community meetings for almost 2 years per child. Juggling the demands of being a researcher with motherhood is challenging. In addition, for many researchers, building a family coincides with the most delicate phase of their career. People often think that becoming a mother is just a matter of a few months of maternity leave, but parenting is a full-time job. Generally, we need interventions to enable female researchers to pursue their research goal in spite of the natural slowdown coming with having a child. Childcare funds are usually aimed at increasing women's participation to research events. However, I believe that the same type of support should be also offered to male researchers facing similar issues. Childcare is a family commitment, not a women's business.
So, two topics. So we've got we heard you about the women dedicated events. Would you like that there are more women dedicated events so that women can be, the speakers and everything? Do we have to do that for example, 5-10 years so that little by little we get used to have female speakers? Is that what you want to say?
Well, I think that the pandemic has left aside not only women, but also junior participants. So as a PhD student, social life is very important, and to meet people in conferences and to explain to these people what you are working on is fundamental. And then we need to regain these people that we have lost in the way. So now I think we should really promote, in particular, women activities just for women, and I go back to this perfect sentence that Anastasia said, this fantastic video that she was like concerned. And we need to draw girls in. Like here, we need to reintegrate again back in the group. And it's a bit, it may sound artificial. Indeed, at the beginning, my first experience in one of these women in geometry anthropology was in Zurich, when I was one of the speakers and Antoni invited me. And I was a bit reluctant. I mean, I was reluctant, these only activities for women. And he convinced me, like, you have really to do something to change this balance. And I think he was right. And as I said, I mean, there are many ways to organize this. The one in Barcelona, we had plenary speakers who were women, and then we had a lot of contributed talks, especially from young participants. This was pre-pandemic, so. And now I think, like, we think that during the pandemic, we have PhD students who started their PhD during the pandemic and didn't have the chance to live this social life that you live in a conference. And I think that this is very important too. So also, I think we should also, in a way, recover also the junior participants. So I think to have, like, why these events, as I said, until when you have that the balance is back to normal, then when you have done this reset of the computer, then you can go, you don't need to have then these women dedicated events. But well, I mean, this is the first thing I thought that, I mean, I'm here, this conference is great. I mean, I was half of the conference away because I was in Freiburg. I mean, I was virtually in Freiburg teaching a course, but I could follow part of the talks. It was amazing, this conference, and all the organizers did a great job. But I still think that there is something that it's clear. I look at the list of speakers, and there are only two female speakers. And I'm sure that the scientific committee made a very good job, and I don't question any of the speakers, of course. But I think that we come to, you know, we are finding ourselves in a moment, in, as Deborah was saying, it's a social thing in which we don't question if this is normal or not. Maybe this is not normal to have only two speakers who are females.
Maybe we can ask them. Why only two women speakers?
It's a little controversial.
She's a little bit criticizing your organization. So
maybe not the organization.
Yes. So maybe you can tell us why only two. Because you ask women and they didn't want to come, or
actually not true. There were more than two women who gave talks. I mean, Mrs. Ogata gave a talk. Michaela Procesi gave a talk. Chiara Sapirio gave a talk.
I'm talking about plenary speakers.
Oh, okay. All right.
I'm asking for everything. I'm asking for the full house. So I want plenary speakers.
He's going to get the answer.
Sure. Yeah. So, yeah, of course, Eva, you're right to criticize, even though I'm not sure whether I can speak for the selection committee, but let me try. Yes. I think the selection committee also saw it as a difficulty and was trying to fight it with some limited success, let's admit.
Yeah.
Thank you.
It's only, we had a talk before and saying, as a journalist, we're always trying to invite women when we've got a debate or when we want to do a report, and we have to fight with women so that they agree to come. We say, you're right, do you the right person? I want to interview. Would you like to be interviewed? And a lot of women just say, oh no, I'm not the right person. Maybe you should interview my colleague. And never a man would do that. They always say, I'm sorry, Mr. They always said, yeah, I'm the good one. Yeah, come and ask me questions. And maybe it's awful a little bit too, as a woman, just not to be confident enough, just to say, I'm the right person to give you the right answer. So maybe we facing that kind of problem everywhere, not only in journalism, but only in your field.
But also there is there is something that I see when I'm in committees, maybe this is what happened in this committee, when I'm in scientific committees or committees for prizes, when there is, I mean, there are women, I mean, and they are named on a list. And what I observe is that often by female and male members of the committee, we tend to question more women than men. And why? I mean, this is not that I say it because I have experienced this, but I have looked at it to know if this is normal, I mean, if this has a name, this is the solo effect. There are so few women that when we see them, we tend to find everyone has a defect, all of us, right? Men and women, but we tend to focus more on the ones on the woman. And I think that when you are in a committee, sometimes it's very difficult to you put the name of a woman, and sometimes it's difficult to have this woman as a speaker in the conference because of this solo effect. This is not a criticism to this conference. I was putting this as an example, and instead of taking a random conference, I took this one. But this is something that happens in all the conferences, and this is a part, as Deborah was saying, that the academia is embedded in a society, and we are inheriting this kind of problems of the society. So we are trying, like, having these woman-dedicated events is a way to a little bit, it's, I don't want to say that this is a gender battle, because this is not a gender battle. This is something to make science better. To make science better, sometimes you know that you cannot solve a problem on your own, and you collaborate with somebody. In the same way, if you leave away, if these women are not present, like now, if I were a PhD student now, it would be very hard for me to imagine myself in academia, because if I come to a conference, I don't see more women who are plenary speakers. I even don't not going to think that this is possible. So I think that to have more women speaking in conferences, in standard conference or women dedicated conference, is a way also to give confidence to the new generations of women. That's what I think.
I heard you, and you say no. So I'm going to bring you my microphone.
Thanks. My name is Volker Bach. I'm from Germany. I've served on many committees, scientific committees for organizing conferences, hiring committees for professor positions, and whatever. And I have to say, all the committees I've served on only judged by scientific criteria. It was completely gender independent. That is A. And B, all funding agencies all over the world demand that conferences have female speakers, and better yet, more than one. And there is a pressure exerted on this already. So I mean, let me just put this as a provocative statement also to what you said in the very beginning. You were in 21 to waiting to have everything to have changed. But I mean, I'm 56 years old, and my childhood was in the 70s. And if I compare the development from the 70s to the situation we live in now, then the development is dramatic as far as the gender equality goes. If you see old movies from the 70s or 80s, there are jokes being cracked in the movies that would be completely unacceptable nowadays, and everybody would agree about this. So what I want to say is there is a development, and developments in societies are not fast. I mean, one should not overdo in trying to push it. That's my opinion. And one more thing, I think this was brought up by you just a minute ago. I observe that many persons that pursue an academic career but eventually do not succeed have in some sense not gained enough independence on their way through their career. They rely very much on formal qualifications. I go through this and this step. And in some sense, I'm worried that this mentoring, yet another mentoring program, is giving another assurance that the way will be successful. But in some sense, it's just the opposite. What is needed is that persons gain independence. And I observe that many women are not, maybe they're lacking self-confidence or so. They're scientifically brilliant, but, you know, they just, as you said, when they ask for an interview, they don't say, yes, just ask me. But rather they'd say, no, ask my colleague. So maybe you comment on this. By the way, I think that what Serena just said in the video was just up to the point. I think this is a very, very important point.
Thank you. Who wants to answer? I was sure, Eva, you are going to.
Well, yeah, I don't know. Well, you come from Germany, and there you have some position for just women and so on. I mean, myself, as a woman, I'm not able to say that I never had unbiased gender bias. I mean, unconscious gender bias. I cannot say. Probably I had it. I mean, even as a woman. I mean, as I said, this is not a war battle. But from your comment, you're saying, oh, some women don't have confidence. You are judging this person. I mean, this person has the right not to have this confidence. And you are judging on an interview some lack of confidence for a scientific position. So what I'm saying is, well, this is not a reply to your question. So what I'm saying is that this is very subtle. The bias, I don't say that people are not giving position to women because they are women. I say that there is some unconscious bias sometimes that we have. I mean, and I don't say this, there is a studies. This John Jennifer thing was done in Yale University. So this happens, this tends to happen, and it happens also when we women are judging maybe some of our PhD students. Maybe we are like, I don't know, myself, I ask myself this question, like I have less female PhD students than PhD students, and I try to, you know, I try to cheer all of them in the same way, but sometimes maybe I fail. Maybe I fail in these two. So I declare myself like guilty of that. So I think it's a global problem. I don't think it's a gender battle or something like this.
But first Anna and then Jörg.
I just want to say something about the topic of today. We come from decades of men dedicated events and men-dedicated positions. So that's where we come from, and we need to transition to something more equal. And I come from the materials science, physics of materials field, which there are a lot of competent women. And even there, it has been long dominated by male, only male get to see, to have the headlines, all these. And it's nice sometimes when there's a conference that it's not publicized as women only, but you see, most of the invited speakers, most of the plenary are women, and it feels good. Even me that I have a position, it feels so good because, you know, it's a time, you know, maybe we lack confidence because very often we're just put down like this, you know, you are inferior, you don't know what you're talking about. It's not majority, but for sensitive people, like intelligent people tend to be more sensitive. When someone puts you down, you kind of feel bad about it and you think, maybe I'm not worth it. So yeah, let people grow. And I think it feels so good to have a lot of female invited speakers. Let us enjoy this.
That was a good, you know, shout. Thank you very much. Jörg, because we've got to end that.
Yes,
because we are even at the time.
Well, I'm glad we discussed these gender issues. However, in order to sort of make a closing statement, I would like to remind the audience that these human rights sessions were created on the initiative of Joe Liebowitz, I think, who is, you know, a distinguished member of our community, now 90 years old. And of course, at the time when he created these sessions, the topics were less about, gender issues and the like, but about helping refuseniks in the Soviet Union, or, for example, women in countries where women are suppressed, and topics like that. And I hope we are not forgetting these topics that are, in many ways, perhaps equally important as the one we debated today. And another little statement. I think we live in a period where we like to debate problems forever, but we never solve them. So if we see problems about, for example, gender inequality, let's just all try to do something about it and solve the problem at least to the extent we are able to. So that would be my pledge. Let's act and not just debate and complain.
Thank you. It's a good conclusion. Eva, you wanted to ask?
Yeah, no, but the videos are things that are done in this direction. So I think people are trying to do something. And I agree very much with what Anna said. I feel very many times like this, and you express it in very nice words. And I think it's the day I see, the day I see a conference of my field where there are more women than men, I think I will never see this. I hope I can see this. And Anton, will I see this?
And Deborah, maybe a last word of conclusion.
A last word. I think that the big difference between perhaps when we were all young researchers and where we find ourselves now is precisely that action is being taken, that there are these programs put in place to create a kind of critical mass of well-qualified, experienced women who are in the position to accept invitations to be plenary speakers at conferences, for example. I think action is the big difference between then and now.
Thank you to all of you. Sorry if we couldn't take your question online or in this room. I'm going to take your words, because in a longer video you said something very important, Eva. You said future belongs to science, and science is for girls and boys, and science needs to be inclusive. I'm sure we're going to manage to resolve that problem. I hope that my two girls, my three boys, that I'm just trying to make them grow, will not face the same problem with their kids. So let's see each other in 20 years, and I hope we're going to have solution. Please, thank you very much.